When you hear the words modern dynasty in the NHL, the first team that jumps to mind will always be the Chicago Blackhawks. But what if I told you that the dynasty was almost over before it all began? But everything changed thanks to one crazy game. To fully explain, we gotta go back to where it all began.
They've waited a long time for this to be at home. For the third time in 6 years, the Blackhawks are Stanley Cup champions.
First time ever the Chicago Blackhawks have had the first pick. We proudly select Patrick Kane. You're watching the future of the Chicago Blackhawks right there.
This is the kind of talent that can bring a franchise back from death.
After selecting Patrick Kane first overall, the future looked brighter than ever. After taking star prospect Jonathan Toews the year prior, excitement to see both players debut in the upcoming season was at an all-time high.
This is the most complete player in the draft, the guy that can play all three zones right now better than anybody else.
And it took no time at all for the excitement to be fulfilled. Just 2 weeks into the franchise's most anticipated season of all time, the future was put on full display. Though Chicago narrowly missed the 2008 playoffs, the next season, they came back in full force, reaching the 100-point mark for the first time since the mid-90s. For the first time in 7 years, the Hawks were playoff-bound. And after convincingly winning the first round, in Game 6 of Round 2, a superstar was officially announced.
All-American. First team, bitch.
Here comes Brian Campbell heading for the net.
Yeah.
Patrick Kane shoots. He scores.
Biggest game of his career so far, Patrick Kane put the team on his back. And for the first time since the mid-90s, the Hawks were going to play in the conference finals. Though they fell to the powerhouse Red Wings, the standard was set. And come 2010, everything looked to be coming to fruition.
Bruh.
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 Bro, what happened? After signing superstar Marian Hossa to a 12-year contract, the next offseason was going to be a big problem. Re-signing Jonathan Toews, Patrick Kane, Duncan Keith, and Nicklas Hjalmarsson was going to be a real big issue. But this made it a whole lot worse. To make it as simple as possible, Talon just had to overpay like crazy for all of his RFAs. But with all the big tickets needing to be signed, this brought a sense of impending doom to Chicago. But if we ignore that fail, the 2010 season was the best in franchise history. Though they fell 1 point shy of the top seed in the West, they finished the season with the most wins and points in the history of the franchise. But when the playoffs rolled around, a first-round matchup against Nashville was going to be an interesting one. Still chasing the first series victory in the franchise's history, Nashville were also looking to exorcise some demons from the past.
We've seen more ice time tonight. He's been good for Nashville. Oh, oh. Here's Franzen. He's in the clear. Franzen right in.
In a closely contested series against the eventual Stanley Cup champions, things could have turned out a lot different had Nashville taken the pivotal Game 5 on the road. Well, or if this weird goal from center never went in Game 6.
Score from center, my goodness! Nick Lidstrom.
And after 2009 saw the Predators miss the playoffs by only 3 points, 2010 seemed to be the year that Nashville were going to get over the hump. In only his second season as starter, Pekka Rinne was already looking to be one of the best goalies in the league. And with one of the league's best defensive cores in front of him, Nashville were one of the toughest teams in the league to play against. When the playoffs rolled around, Nashville had notched themselves the number 7 seed in the West. But like always, question marks were ultimately going to be raised. So far in the young history of the franchise, like previously stated, they had failed to win a single playoff series. But even worse was the fact that up until this point, Nashville hadn't won a single playoff game on the road. And going into Game 1, everything seemed to be following the exact same tale.
Still nothing, thanks to 50 of the plays that we have documented for you tonight. Here come the Hawks back. The shot and the rebound put in the net. Green ain't got it at Rick initially, but couldn't hold it. And the Blackhawks
strike. Heading into the third period without a goal, seemed like absolutely nothing was going to get by Niemi.
Bruh.
Costly error from Chicago proved to be...
Wait, no.
Now bringing in Langlois. He's done. Back control area to score. JP Dumont put in.
Bro, and yeah, just like that, Nashville had knocked off one of the more embarrassing stat lines in the NHL. But obviously, that's not the goal that they were striving for. They really wanted to put the pressure on. A 2-0 lead in the series would do just that. But in Game 2, Chicago evened up the series. And hoped to do the same in Game 3. Okay, well, heading into Game 4, a loss in one of the league's loudest arenas would mean a 3-1 series deficit. And at this point in time, it was a deficit that the Blackhawks had never come back from in France. Bro, what is that? Stop!
The Blackhawks tally on the power play, and the rebound put in the net, breaking in, he scores! And the Hawks even up the series with a 3-0.
Oh, nice. And after the Hawks tied the series, it was a best of three. And the pivotal Game 5 at the Madhouse was next.
NBC Sports from Chicago presents the NHL Stanley Cup Playoffs. At face-off this afternoon, 22,000 people will watch Game 5 of the best of 7 tied at 2. The Chicago Blackhawks...
No matter which way the result went, the game tonight was going to be a turning point in the series. In big games like this, the first goal is always important. And both teams knew this.
Duncan Keith named as a finalist yesterday as that one came off the goal post. Timmins, Ontario native, able to come up with that and flip one that careened across and is read and held there by Legwand. He scores! Legwand! And it's 1-0.
Though scoring the first goal was massive, a two-goal cushion would be one to die for. Though Nashville were pushing for the two-goal cushion, Chicago were having absolutely none of it. After the tying goal from Chicago, the score remained the same heading into the second.
This will do it for the first period. 2-1 in favor of Chicago.
And after a defensive first half of the second period, when both teams traded penalties, it looked like the game was about to get blown wide open.
John Madden, who's done a lot of this since his days at Michigan, sees this Connor though by Weber. Laid it on a cross and set up now for Arden. Weber a drive, and he didn't get all of that one. Kane out of the box, but he couldn't take the pass.
And when both teams reached full strength, the chaos began.
That shot is blocked down by Tate. Turnaround shot, getting his glove on that. Spun across to Kane. Felder's a little pass. Bickle up with it now. Drifts and shoots. Oh, and it's fought off by Rene. Bickle playing in just his second Stanley Cup playoff game. Campbell fed it across. Drive by Keith is blocked aside by Rene, and the shot total has climbed to 20 to just 5 for Nashville.
Shea Weber cannot get off the ice. He is absolutely dead tired right now.
It is Taves giving it across, and a shot hit the outside of the net near the post by Sharp. And we are going to get a stoppage of play. And
hold up. Wait a minute. Something ain't right.
We are going to get a stoppage of play, and what have we?
Too many men on the ice for
for Chicago.
You just saw the six, one too many, and it wasn't even close. Nashville with a big, big opportunity.
With a chance to tie the game, Nashville was not going to let this one slip.
104 plus, but he finished second to Zdeno Chara at 105.4. Drive, and that's blocked right back by Jalmerson. And cleared back down and racing back for it. Tomaski moving on in.
And as if things couldn't get any better, almost instantly after the goal, Chicago were right back on the power play. A goal to make it 4-1 would all but put the game to bed.
Hold up.
Lorenzo, what a bad play by Patrick Kane. He's going to feel a ton of shame on this.
Though the shorthanded goal was tough, Chicago still had the lead heading into the third. And if they were able to hold on, it would mean a date back in Nashville to close out the series.
Bruh.
It is a goal that's scored by Martin Erat. And this game is tough.
Well, after the goal from Erat, Chicago's two-goal lead had evaporated. But in a game of such magnitude and a season with expectations so high, the Blackhawks were not going to...
Chicago Blackhawks had two center icemen on the ice, John Madden and David Bolin. So they were protected in terms of having somebody kicked out, but the Nashville Predators do a great job getting puck possession, and now they have one goal lead.
Well, after Erat made it three consecutive goals by the Preds, all the life was sucked out of the United Center.
And what Nashville's done is amazing. They've just quieted 22,000 people. There is no emotion in this crowd at all. These guys are the king of resiliency, Nashville Predators. It's unbelievable how tough they are. On the Blackhawk bench, I think they're shocked that they're down by a goal now.
And as the time on the clock slowly but surely bled away, the heartbreak was becoming all too likely. Nashville weren't going to give Chicago a chance.
And how about the shot block right there?
And after calling the timeout, Chicago had 90 seconds to get a goal, or else it was going to mean a must-win game back in Nashville. And just before the clock hit the final minute, as the puck was being dumped into the zone, and in the worst case scenario, Marian Hossa was given a 5-minute major. Didn't get a game misconduct, I don't really, whatever. And just one bad play jeopardized the entire Chicago season. Now, something we gotta remember about Marian Hossa is that in this present moment, he is the most cursed man in hockey. After being on the losing end in the Stanley Cup Finals for two consecutive seasons, 2010 seemed as though it was gonna be Hossa's year. But when you pair this incident with the fact that Marian Hossa had yet to score in the playoffs, it seemed like the Hossa curse was all too real. We also have to understand that 2010 was a make-or-break season for Chicago. The upcoming salary cap restraints were knowingly going to cause a large roster turnover. And after this season, 9 regular players from Chicago's roster were moved. But back to present moment. All Nashville had to do was play keep away for 60 seconds and the game would be over. That's exactly what they were doing. Playing four corners in Chicago's zone, as the puck was sent in deep, it fell right to Martin Erat. And all he had to do was hold on to the puck or find an open teammate and the game would be all but wrapped up.
Kane scored. I think everybody in the building just felt this team has that something that you need to win.
And in storybook fashion, we were somehow headed to overtime.
Back here at United Center in Chicago, the attendance was 22,155. perhaps a handful, are on the Eisenhower now, wondering what they did in the last minute to leave here. Arnott and Dumont. Arnott's a Stanley Cup clincher.
Oh, I forgot about that. Instantly brought down to earth, Chicago realized they were going to have to do the best penalty killing possible for the next 4 minutes. But that is exactly what they did. As the time ticked away slower than ever, Chicago knew that if they could kill off this penalty, they could do anything. And at long last, the hard work seemed to have paid off. Right as the penalty was about to expire, Dave Boland got a break.
Bruh.
But then the puck hit the linesman's skate and fell to Brent Sopel, one of the least offensive guys on the entire team. But one thing that Sopel did have was patience.
That was when I first knew that we had a real chance of getting our first Stanley Cup in however many years.
If you look back in hindsight, you can kind of pinpoint those moments that you kind of came close to being knocked out or being against the ropes. I think we can all look at Game 5 as a pretty make-or-break moment for us.
Pretty much everybody in the room started to believe that we can win the whole Stanley Cup.
That was the game that got us going. We weren't playing at the top of our game the first four games. Once we hit that, it was churning full steam ahead from there.
And after somehow winning Game 5 after looking defeat right in its eyes, all it was going to take was one more game in Nashville. And after cruising by Nashville in Game 6, the rest is history.
To the net, it's over. For the first time since 1961, the Chicago Blackhawks have won the Stanley Cup.
And once the run was all said and done, Blackhawks fans could do nothing but appreciate that one faithful game.
Stuart, what the hell are you doing?
What?
You didn't do the script. There's a whole part missing.
What are you talking about?
Game 6.
No, what? Like, what are you talking about? What do you mean?
Against Nashville.
I did that already. Hold on.
There's a script there. I don't. There's a script. You didn't do it.
Game 6.
Why did you not do this? I gave you a script. You didn't read it.
What script? Oh, what? Oh. No, you, bro, you got the date mixed up. No, this is about 2008. This
you're
is
an idiot.
2010.
You're,
yeah, I talked about
you're an
it.
Idiot.
It literally says, Game 6 was a defensive showdown that was blown wide open by a weird goal from center. I've been through this already.
You haven't watched Game 6, have you? 2010.
You
haven't watched Game 6, have you?
No.
Okay, just go watch it. Just go watch it and do the script, okay?
All right, I mean, sure. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Yeah, I'll watch it. All right, see ya. What the fuck is this guy talking about?
On Duncan Keith, but... Whoa! And the shot from right side of center ice finds its way into the net.
Damn, bro, that's fucking tough, Nashville. Oh, my God.